are these things? These are all part of a different internet which exists below, a step below the regular internet that we use. And we will quickly go through the motivation behind this so-called darknet. What is it? How do we get there? What is really there out in the darknet jungle? We are looking at the... Now, this is the Matrix.
Yes.
You must have seen the movie.
The Red Pill.
Oh, well, not the Red Pill. I don't know. How many Redditors here? Are there any people who use Reddit? Okay, several people. The Red Pill has a very special connotation on Reddit. So anyway, I won't get into that. So if you look at 4chan, 7chan, you must have heard some of these things. These are sites that literally make your brain melt if you really get into 4chan. Reddit, Anonymous, these are some of the groups that are very active in the fringes of the internet. Not mainstream. And before I go any further, there should be a disclaimer at this point. Some of the things that you see here, I don't have any control. When I'm going live, I have no control over what's going to come here. So if you see what are offensive things to you, nothing is offensive to me, but if it's offensive to you, I apologize for that. But there's nothing I can do about it. So you must have heard of Anonymous, it's a hacker collective. Now many of these people are obsessed with anonymity. Some of them are activists. Some of these tools that are used for anonymizing oneself are ironically developed by the US military. And the prime one there is the first Tor, which we'll see shortly. The Matrix is about the military-industrial complex, which many activists feel that is driving the whole world. And someone actually referred to this in their presentation earlier. And the reality is all kind of fabricated. It's not the real reality that we are actually seeing. I wanted to ask Olivia when he was making his presentation about the search engines. We type something in Google and we get a bunch of results. What is the guarantee that this is reality?
Yes.
There is absolutely no guarantee. You know, if you search from one country and another country at the same time, you may get different results. It all depends on the search engine policy.
Yes.
And as we become more and more embedded into this kind of a reality, we must realize that this is a matrix. This is the reality that is being shown to us, and it may not be the real reality, if there is such a thing. So, philosophically, the whole anonymizing movement is about some of these things, and how to be able to kind of make your point of view very clear, free, without getting caught by the governments and this whole complex which is monitoring you all the time. And of course, these tools were used in some of the revolutions, uprisings in Tunisia, Egypt, and so on. And I will not get into so much about mathematics, but the underpinnings of the entire set of tools that are used here are actually based at cryptography. And we will see a quote later which says, no amount of violence will solve a mathematical problem. Cryptography is based on mathematics. The state and the police cannot force this problem to be solved by pointing guns at you. So this is the only way, otherwise if it's something soft, people can always be manipulated. So now, none of the cryptographic algorithms are impossible to break. They have been broken, they have been compromised, but they are computationally infeasible. That means, if you have a supercomputer, maybe you can break one message. But if you have thousands of messages whizzing by, you cannot break all of them. The amount of computing required is actually too much. Not impossible, but just infeasible. Some of the design principles. First is, no server is trusted. Nothing is trustable. Now if you, later on when you look at Bitcoin, you'll see that it is slightly modified into that majority are not malicious. There would be malicious players, there would be dishonest players, but the majority, 50% plus of the whole internet is not like that. That's an assumption. But Tor assumes that all servers are compromised. All servers have the complex of the matrix agents monitoring, trying to break. Nothing is centralized, because centralization is a single point of failure, a vulnerability. So nothing is centralized, everything is decentralized. Now when there's something called Napster, which is centralized peer-to-peer, the first generation peer-to-peer, they had a central server. It is easy to shut it down. because there was a central server. But if you don't have a head, you can't cut off anybody's head. So that is the same principle applied here. No centralized activities, cluster activities. Surveillance safeguards, encryption, many kinds of proxies. Plausible deniability. If you're ever taken to the court, do you have some way that you can say this? Well, it's not 100% provable that you did something. This is a more a legal kind of a thing than technologically. Of course, technology is kind of applied to get there. Anonymous services and trade. Okay, this I'll skip completely. It's not relevant for this group. ClearNet, some words. ClearNet is the internet that we normally use. The darknet is a subset of ClearNet where the traffic is encrypted, anonymized, using certain tools. If you do not have those tools, we cannot see the darknet, although it exists right under our nose. Now, what are these tools? The most commonly used tool is the is Tor. Tor is the T-O-R, the onion router, T-O-R, the onion router. There are things like more advanced versions of these things called mixnets. Now, mixnets are even more difficult to crack. Now, Tor has been, there's been at least one case that you will refer to, where Tor has been kind of compromised. But Tor, the Tor designers claim that that is not a compromise, it is a design aspect of Tor. So there are multiple tools, but the most common thing is the Tor. And the exit node, what's an exit node? If you're in Tor circuit, we'll see the picture later. The last link, suppose I am typing in Tor google.com. I'll get google.com after a brief delay. Now it is going through several servers in the middle, all Tor servers. The last one from the last server to the Google site is unencrypted. And the last server is called the exit node. That is where the traffic comes out to the clear net. And it's vulnerable there because if somebody is tracking that one, it can figure out certain things about us, although not the entire thing. Onion routing, we will see onion and garlic routing. That's another kind of routing, which is a special case used in I2P. So we will, because time is limited, we are not going to get into details of any of these. Anonymous is used for different purposes. Primarily, I've been a heavy user of Tor for many, many years now. And I use it because I don't want to leave any traces of what I do in my own computer. Not that anybody is monitoring it, but I don't want to leave any traces. Not because anybody is surveilling on me. I hope not. I don't know, but hope not. So why do people use this? So I always get this question as to, is this all illegal? Why did US Navy create a tool like this that can be used for illegal activities? Now remember, nation states have, sometimes there's a need for illegal, what we call as illegal. This is actually developed for spies in different parts. Basically, US Navy had different people giving them information. You can all call them all spies, but some of them were. And they wanted a technology where these people in different countries around the world could communicate with the US military without them getting caught. That was the origin of this. Subsequently, it's been taken over by the open source community. Both things that we discussed here today, darknet and Bitcoin, and the whole cryptocurrencies, are based on open source. And open source, in turn, assumes a free and open internet. And this is at the foundation, the internet, the free and open internet is the foundation of all these things that we're discussing. Right, so why do we want these tools? So in some countries, there is censorship. And some citizens and activists, they want to go beyond censorship. They want to report on things that they're not allowed to report. They can use this. By users who want to protect against identity theft. People who are maybe very, very concerned about their own identities. By government agencies and military agencies who want to pass on information. And by the libertarians who believe that the matrix is always monitoring them. This is a bunch of people. Tor was a US Navy project. Why do you call it the onion router? What is onion about this? And you also saw that the URL ended in .onion. So, this is funded by many agencies, and they got an award to the Free Software Foundation, Stallman's Foundation. Stallman has been actually here in this particular room, in this podium, several times, and we have brought him here. Stallman is a kind of visionary in the free software, not open source. This is a minor but important political difference, which I will not get into right now. The free software people consider that he is the kind of their visionary. And the citation said that using free software, Tor has enabled roughly 36 million people around the world to experience the freedom of access and expression on the internet. while keeping them in control of their privacy and anonymity. Its network has proved pivotal in dissident movements in both Iran and more recently in Egypt. This is 2010. So this is a kind of use. Now, if you ask the Iranians or the Egyptians, they might say that this is illegal, what you're using Tor for. For the rest of the world, like what Olivier said, one man's freedom fight is another man's whatever, whatever. So that principle applies. Now, this is the reason why we call it onion. Now, look at this message. The M here is the message. And it is actually encrypted with several layers of the public keys of all these servers in the circuit. The circuit is figured out by the Tor software in your browser. So it goes from here to here to here, then here, and then here. And the whole thing is a clear net. All other computers are sitting there, they're not part of the Tor circuit. The Tor circuit is that arrows that are there. Now, this is when the message is prepared here, it is meant for this destination. And it's encrypted with the public keys of all the en route servers, starting with the one of the last. This is the last one. So the innermost encryption layer is the public key of this, then this, then this, then this. So as the packet goes there, that one strips off, because it's got its own private key. It strips off that one layer and gets back something slightly smaller. This way, each subsequent layer gets stripped, and finally here it is clear text. And this link with dashed arrows is actually unencrypted plain text circuit. So here the message can be seen. And if there is a monitoring software running on this node, they can see all this packet from there to the end, the target site. So this is a point of vulnerability. In fact, it is known that many countries' intelligence agencies are monitoring many of these exit nodes. So that they want to know. They will not be able to know where this packet has come from. But they will be able to know where this packet is going and what are the contents of that message. Let me now start this so that you can get a sample of... So let it come. So this is Firefox. If you look at the browser, it's just plain Firefox. But it's actually running through the Tor circuit. And here you can see, here you can see the onion itself. And you can, these are various settings. You can change the identity each time you want. You can change the circuit, etc. And I will search for the hidden wiki. The hidden wiki is a good starting point to see, because now again, like I said, what comes up here, I have no control over it. And also, many of the links that you see will be dead. A whole lot of things on the darknet are either non-existent or outright fraud. So for example, you find a site that sells US passports for $500. And how this $500 will be paid? Through Bitcoin. And what is one of the characteristics of Bitcoin? If you make a payment, you can't reverse it. Now this fellow, for all we know, is a fraud. He's just got a site saying that I will sell you, pictures of passports and all that. You pay him, nothing happens. You have no recourse. There's no way to kind of get your money back. There are people who think that they will take out, meaning what locally is called as quotation killers. So you want an enemy to be taken out, there are these sites that offer that contract. You pay them money, your money is gone. So don't believe everything that appears on the... Yeah, so let us look at... it's coming up. Now, all this encryption has a cost in terms of performance. When you use Tor as a front end, you can contact any other normal site, and that site will not know who you are. The cookies cannot identify. In fact, there's also services. You can not only contact a different computer anonymously, but you can also offer a service that other people can contact, like a server. That's called a hidden service. And that can even be behind a NAT. If you know what a NAT is, it's when one IP is shared by many people. Usually you cannot do that. You cannot have an incoming telnet connection. But using this, you can actually have a site inside that is a server. And all these are called .onion, but there's no DNS. So ICANN's work doesn't really enter this, because there's no DNS. And that has been, of course, discussed lots of times in ICANN. So since these servers are anonymous, people sell lots of things which are otherwise illegal. And what do they sell? We will see some examples. These are some examples of the URLs. All of them ended with .onion. But here are some of the, this is Silk Road. It was brought down about 3 years back by US government. And that guy is in jail now. Now, you can see what they have to sell. Most of it is some kind of MDMA and, these are the stuff. So this is arms. So you can see people's drugs too. Right. So these are some of the things that exist there. Let us take a look at. So here is our. So here you can see many of the URLs. Right. So you must remember at least 40 to 50% are non-existent frauds. I mean, outright fraud. I mean, there's no chance of them being. Here you can see, so for example, a Bitcoin laundry. Now, Bitcoin has a problem that it's not fungible. Now, what do you mean by fungible? If I borrow 100 rupees from you, I can return that back in 250 rupee notes. Or any kind of combination. That person does not expect that I pay him back the same note that I got from him. That's called fungibility. If I borrow your car, if I borrow your Maruti rented car, I cannot return another Ford Escort or whatever back to you. Because cars are not fungible at all. Money is fungible. Bitcoin, unfortunately, although it's money, it is not fungible because we can actually trace where this money came from. So sometimes you have a problem that there's tainted Bitcoins. For example, ransomware payments. Ransomware payments are in Bitcoin. Although you don't know who the party is, you can actually trace the actual coin itself. There's a number for it. And you can say that this particular, there are some sites which do not accept tainted coins, Bitcoins. So you can actually whitewash it, or you can money laundering, like money launderings. You pay some Bitcoin, get back Bitcoins, but you lose the commission. And you get back untainted Bitcoins out of tainted Bitcoins. So these are some of the services that exist. Right? I2P is another tool, which is much lesser known tool, but equally powerful. I will not get into the details of this. Freenet is the third tool. Transactional uses. Normally, you start by using for reading other people's website, other website, without revealing who you are. That's the first step use. The second step of use is when you host some data, you host a website, and you don't want the government to know it is my website. Now, this is a double-edged weapon. In situations where you don't want the government to know, that's a legitimate use, maybe. But suppose you have a website and you have a problem of somebody uploading a picture of a nude girl there, and the girl wants it pulled down. You cannot pull it down. Why is that? Because you don't know where that is. You don't know which jurisdiction that's coming. That server may be anywhere. So it is a double-edged sword. You have a problem with some of these services that way. And the final level is when you can do transactions. You can, just like an e-commerce, eBay site and so on, you can actually transact. And this was not actually possible without Bitcoin, because you could not make a payment without a middle entity, a trusted party like the credit card company or the bank. But when Bitcoin came, that constraint was removed, and you could make a payment without any intermediary. And that is when the hidden services began to kind of explode, and there were lots of. Now, for the government, if you look at from the security agency side, the biggest threat here is that you cannot detect this traffic. If you have a gateway, you cannot figure out that there is Tor traffic that's happening. And even if you detect, you cannot break it, because like I said, it is computationally not feasible. There is a problem of illegal, all things like drugs and so on, firearm explosives, nuclear material, activated SIM cards, poisons, counterfeit currency. All this can technically, now there is actually an interesting problem here, because okay, you may make the payment in Bitcoin, but to ship that damn thing, what is called as fulfillment, at that step you need to use a real-time or in real-life process. The postman has to bring it to your place. For that, if you are reporting from some other country, there may be customs checks. If you send drugs, they will catch you. They may catch you. So those issues are all there. So, but still, now, if you can't get your money back, there is no way to cover your risk. How do people transact on these sites without, I mean, they must be very, very adventurous to make a payment without being sure that you get the product. So these sites work on reputation. There is a community there, and there's a reputation that's being added by everybody who's... So somebody says, I didn't get the shipment, the reputation goes down, and less people will be coming forward to place their orders. That's the only way that it's being used currently. Okay, Bitcoin will trade separately. Court convictions are difficult. So in the case of Silk Road, that guy was, the owner was caught after a long amount of surveillance by the US government. They kept on watching him, collecting evidence for a long time. And then only they confronted him and arrested him. There is a traffic confirmation attack. This happens when there is a agency which has got massive coverage in a country. And the entry node and the exit node are both in the same country. And they have abundant computing power. When that happens, they can keep on strategically examining all connections and from that pattern extract what could probably be an entry point, exit point and so on, they can try to figure out. Now Tor designers said that this is not an exploit but a design parameter of Tor. Tor is not designed to withstand this kind of an attack. Opportunities maybe depends on who you are. If you're the government, none of these are opportunities. Unless you're a spy agency. So basically darknet that we saw. Now if you check the actual network again, the links that we just saw, now many of these are, you can click on the random one and see what happens. The chances are pretty good that nothing will open up. Because these sites come and go for various reasons. There's no guarantee that they will be there. After a while it might time out. Now, Sheep is another marketplace. There have been many cases where the marketplaces have shut down and taken people's money with them. All the Bitcoin balances in that thing has been stolen, basically. So some of these are, the whole marketplace is a racket. So it's not a very safe place at all. And if you think you would like to play around with it, that's okay. But if you are going to do anything more significant, well, in fact, this presentation was actually created for a security agency in Delhi. And I'd gone there and made this presentation some 3-4 years back. Right, so it's not coming. So most likely these are So in India now, the security agencies, the law enforcement is actually expanding. Earlier on they were not bothered about this. But now they are actually concerned. The public was not generally aware of many of these things. But in 2014 there was an article in the a prominent newspaper, which detailed out these things. I have lots of friends who, especially in the free software community, who believe that this is a matter of right, and nobody has access to, should have access to my private stuff. So, and it is possible that some of the security agencies in India are operating exit nodes in India. So they are monitoring traffic. In the US, they monitor everybody who's not a US citizen, maybe even some US citizens. But increasingly, this might be happening in India also. We have no information, but we know that there's an increased effort to track traffic. So that's with darknet. Are there any questions? Yes.
So thank you for that presentation. So my question is, on one side we have anonymity and privacy, which is given by tools like Tor browser. And on the other side we have legality, which is preventing us, telling us not to use it. So how do we actually balance both? And as a user, I would definitely go for privacy and anonymity. But at the same time, as a person who would like to follow legal rules, I'm also bound not to use them. So how do I balance
those? Maybe the lawyers here can help me, but I don't think there's any law that says we cannot use the
product. No, but in the legality perspective.
There's no law that he says we cannot use this. As far as the legal system is concerned, they're not aware of this. So there's nothing to stop you in that sense. But if you think it's morally wrong, that's your problem.
So just one thing I can add from legal perspective would be that while there's nothing wrong with using Tor, some countries have actually banned the use of VPN technology, and including UAE, for example. So and they've even made a criminal offense to use VPN or any circumvention tech to access something which is otherwise blocked. So that's one thing to maybe keep in mind. The second thing I just wanted to, based on your presentation, so now I think it is actually possible for a network admin to detect Tor traffic based on signatures. So I've had a chat with somebody from the Tor project as well sometime back, and they confirmed that they've slowly started detecting what is Tor traffic. I mean, it's a broad-based thing where you block all kinds of traffic you can't identify, but that in most cases is going to be Tor traffic, and then people have managed to successfully block it en masse as opposed to like targeted blocking. So that's one thing which I think
you can also block. You can also block it. You can block certain ports and ensure that Tor traffic cannot go out. Just like you can block VPNs.
Right. So yeah, it's detectable now as opposed to normal other traffic.
Yeah.
Any
questions?
Sir,
yeah. Yes. Yeah. 1, 2. Please.
Yeah. In case of Tor transactions, what is clearly possible to hold is the physical movement of the goods. So, are there any other examples other than Silk Road where non-physical evidences has been tracked down and brought to court?
See, if there is international shipment, then the customs can scan every incoming package, and they can detect if there's any illegal stuff in it. That is possible. In fact, there is one service in Tor in some of these markets which will simulate a package. So you can say that you send a package to my home, and they will see the person is supposed to see just to figure out if there's any police watching me. So if the package is delivered without any problems by the whosoever is delivering it, nobody is asking any questions, then they are reasonably sure that there's nobody tracking them. And that's a paid service. You have to pay money. They'll put some paper and make a package, ship it. So there's no guaranteed way to do otherwise.
No, this I'm asking with a specific reference. Recently, there was a big drug scam happening in Hyderabad with film people and other people. And police could arrest some people. And the evidence is not clearly contestable in the court.
I think there is some amount of traffic of these things even otherwise. Even if you discount the whole dark net, there is still traffic. So it is just as much as that.
Excuse me, sir.
This one, and then who's the other one?
Sir.
Okay, right. After this.
So this is based on your experience on the dark web. Before Bitcoin, how would financial transactions take place?
Couldn't. Because it's traceable. And that takes out the whole point of anonymizing. Because the bank will know who you are. A credit card company will know. So it's not possible to do that. It was not possible, actually. Yes.
So in Orient routing, it uses public key of intermediates. So how it ensures it goes through the same path?
Well, that's a regular routing. The packets are routed as TCP IP packets. And for that, those packets, the IP is a regular IP routing.
But it uses intermediate public key. That is the way it has been encrypted.
IP packet. There is a normal header which says the source and destination and all that. Then there's a data payload. And that is encrypted with all these keys. So one of the consequences of that is that if you take 1 KB of data and you wrap it around all these layers, that will become 10 KB. But the TCP header will manage it just like any other data. For the TCP header, it's just data. But the Tor at the receiving side will know this is Tor. Yes.
Yeah, in one of your picture diagrams, the intermediate part was the ClearNet, and the beginning was the encrypted, and then the last was unencrypted. Why it is so?
Because Google does not know about any darknet. Google is running a regular server. But I want to be anonymous and connect to Google, not in my regular capacity, that Google will know who I am because it keeps track of who I am. But if I use Tor, Google does not know who I am.
But for the last one, anybody will know?
Yeah, but that node also does not know where this packet originated from.
Okay.
It will know the target. The final thing is Google it will know, but it won't know where it came from.
Is it okay to me to explain that in understandable manner about the darknet and the normal net?
We have
just
we have
2 minutes.
5 minutes over. It's 1 minute.
Okay, 1 minute. Okay. Now, normally, in the normal network, we all request, I mean, it goes to the website. It's like a supermarket advertising, and they have a store, and you go, you ask from all the public people, they know where the supermarket is located at. So you directly go, and they know that you are going to the supermarket. But if you see a drug dealer, and the drug dealer knows only the people who are drinking the drugs and selling the drugs. So one person goes to another person, and that goes to another person. Maybe the person who is selling, he doesn't know the person who is using the drugs. But it's going on the same road, same supermarket, same places, but you don't know. Only the people knows who the dealers know. In that they only know the encrypted one, codings or whatever the system. See, that's a similar setup.
Right, thank you for
the
explanation.
Sir? Would you like to comment on the darknet social media? Like, I have read about that Facebook and Google are also coming on darknet to spread their network out there as well.
Facebook did it, but unfortunately, even through the darknet, you need to identify your telephone number, which makes it pointless.
Yeah.
Many people wrote to Facebook saying, what the hell is this? Why do you want to bother it to give a kind of onion address when you want to still ask for your telephone number? So that's fairly meaningless. But there are, of course, many other social media in that way that you can use.
Like forums and all.
Yeah, plenty, plenty.
Thank you.
Right, so shall we then move on? Yeah, last question.
So about the exit nodes. As well, many a times the blame comes to the exit nodes, right?
That's true. Yeah. Because all this traffic seems to originate from the exit node.
Right. So so there's a chance that these exit nodes could be targeted and...
The law enforcement can target exit nodes. But then, the thing is, if you ask me who's running all these nodes, interestingly, it is being run by many agencies, including government agencies, universities, anybody who volunteers. So they're just running it. So if tomorrow there's a policy by the US government saying that no, nobody should run this, of course it will be challenged, but if that comes up, they will have a problem. So, but otherwise, yeah, the traffic seems to originate from the exit node. And if there is offensive traffic to the site concerned, then there's a problem. Right, let's move on with the second presentation, sorry. Yeah. This is a quick one on Bitcoin. There are experts here in this domain as well. So if I go wrong, please feel free to correct me. First question, what is this?
Yes.
Okay, this is actually coins.
Stone coins.
This is coins, and this is from the island of Yap. In the Federated States of Micronesia. It's part of the Pacific. You can see that these are cylindrical stones. There's a hole there because it's so heavy and difficult to kind of maneuver. And actually, this is a small island, and these stones are cut from the neighboring island. And the bigger they are, the more the value, obviously. And they are brought in a boat to this island. Now, the difficulty with these coins, when you transact with them, it's a small island, the community knows each other very well. But the problem is that they have to maneuver these heavy things. That's why they are carrying it to that hole is there to put a stick inside. Now, as they started using these coins, they found that it's very laborious to cut these things around. So they said, look, let's dump these coins here and there. And when I'm paying my coin to you, I'll say, okay, I'm giving you the coin which is in front of John's house. So I'm not giving it physically because it's too much bother, because it's a small community. So then it happened that once a stone is being brought from the other island in a boat, the boat capsized, the stone fell into water. No problems, the stone at the bottom of the sea is yours now. So now, what is really happening? Why am I talking about these stones? The point here is that this is a currency. And the currency is a token of value. And it's not the value of the stone that matters. It is how much you impute, how much the community collectively imputes as value of the stone that matters. So these are basically tokens, and the value is based on the trust. Now we will see that in the whole of Bitcoin, what has really changed is this one word, trust. The revolution is not in technology, it's not in economics, although there is a new discipline called crypto finance, crypto economics. It is really not in any of these either. It is actually in trust, the trust model that we're using. So it's a token of a consensus decision. There is a consensus among the islanders that this is the value of this stone, wherever it is, even if it's in the bottom of the sea. And digital currencies are tokens like others. Now, the normal currency that we use is called fiat currency in the context of cryptocurrencies. And fiat currencies always require a trusted intermediary. It could be a bank, it could be a credit card company, it could be the government, but there has to be one or more, at least one. Trusted intermediary is required when you talk about fiat currencies. And these trusted intermediaries actually play a useful role. They guarantee the transaction. Like if I take a loan and I repay in the local legal tender, that person cannot say that I cannot accept this. He is bound to accept this. That's because it's a legal tender. Now what are the consequences of having an intermediary? Is that the intermediary can freeze your account under certain circumstances. If the intermediary is not cooperating, they can stop your transaction. They can lose your data. They can be hacked because they're a central point where all this data is put. So having an intermediary is not always good, but it works for most of us. All of us use banks, and we have our accounts there, the money is there. The bank also takes care of your money. Whatever balance you have, they take care of it. And you're not scared of losing that money. So this is some of the values of an intermediary. But the problems are also there. If you're operating in the fringe areas that we just saw earlier in the darknet, you do not want a bank to be involved in those transactions. And you want some other way of transacting where there is no intermediary. Now, we have to understand first where the motivation of Bitcoin. We saw this IETF quote on the first day. IETF says, we reject kings, presidents, and voting. Now, this is a very dramatic statement. All of us are talking about democracy. We are saying democracy is the best thing ever. But IETF is saying, we don't trust voting. We can understand they don't reject kings. Rejecting kings is fine. But presidents and voting, what prompted them to say that? Now, the problem is that they believe in rough consensus and running code. Running code, they're all techies, as are many of us, and running code is our currency. We don't talk about anything else but our code. Here's my code, and it works. That is the ultimate proof as far as techies are concerned. Rough consensus, because voting, if you note, even in Indian democracy, we can win with one vote.
A single vote.
There is a real flaw in the system that you don't have the majority with your inner side, you have this one extra. So, voting is perhaps not the best way to arrive at decisions when it comes to this kind of a, when you want to ensure that you have most people with you. Rough consensus maybe. Now, what is rough consensus? I'll not get into that. You talked about this sometime back, that they hum and all that. But it's a very interesting statement as far as I'm concerned, because rejecting voting is a very dramatic statement. The other one that I mentioned earlier, no amount of violence will ever solve a math problem, which is why cryptography is at the base of this entire cryptocurrencies. So 2008, there was a paper which came out on the internet called called Bitcoin, a peer-to-peer electronic cash system. Nobody knows who wrote it. It's one person, one group, it's a group of people, no idea. So Satoshi Nakamoto is a name given. So he's a kind of semi-fictional folklore character today. A lot of effort has been spent in trying to track down Nakamoto. Nobody's succeeded so far. So that is that. This is the domain has also registered anonymously. What is the design objective? The design objectives are, first, enable direct transfer of value between two parties that are not known to each other. So I don't know this person that I'm giving this money to, but I can still transact. Number two, there should not be any trusted intermediary in the loop. The money transfer is direct. Number three, this should happen even when there are malicious actors in the network. Of course, it's all happening on the public network, on the internet. And even when we are absolutely sure that there are malicious, dishonest actors on the internet, this transaction should work without an intermediary. Now, what is malicious? People who provide nodes on the internet who provide wrong information deliberately, or people nodes that try to hack the records, try to change historical records, or double spending. That is, I have a, this often this question when the Bitcoin first came, people used to ask me, in my case what happened is 2013, I spent some money and got some Bitcoins. In March of 2013, I spent about 10,000 rupees local currency. It was very difficult to get Bitcoins because it was not available in India. I had to transfer some money to a London bank and buy it and keep it. Now, end of that year, December, this is in March. In December, my son is getting married. I said, I want all the money that I can get. So I kind of sold these Bitcoins. And that's all. So 10,000 gave me 90,000 in this period. So, don't clap, it's a very risky investment. I could have, might have lost the whole thing also. So, now people, so my son the other day came and asked me, I want to invest in money in Bitcoin. I said, why do you want to do that? He says, as an investment. I said, it's a very bad investment. Are you prepared to lose entire money? Then you can invest. So he said, okay, then in that case, I'll just put a little bit. He just wants to learn how it is. Now, as an investment, I will not guarantee, I will not recommend it to just about anybody. If you are very sure that you can lose the entire thing, then go ahead. But if you are really investing in life savings, don't do that. Although the news is all good about the actual the appreciation of the Bitcoin, the value actually. So people used to ask me, if you have this in your wallet, can you copy the wallet and get double the coins? No, obviously not. If that's the case, you are copying all the time. But what the reason is this. In the wallet that you have, you don't keep the coins. The coins are on the blockchain. It is in the public record. What you have is actually your private key that gives you access to your coins. If you lose that private key, if suppose your hard disk crashes, your laptop crashes, you lose it, that is irrevocably lost. There's no way to get it back. Okay, but it's a private key that you're losing, and thereby access to the coins, your own coins, which are on the blockchain. The blockchain is like a public record, as you will see. So Bitcoin is based on cryptography, it's currency. It is supposed to be used for making payments, financial transfers. It assumes that network has malicious actors, but that these are not the majority. That malicious actors do not control the majority of computing power, 51% of computing power. That's a very major assumption. But today, if you look at what's happening, a lot of mining activity going on, with hash rates running into billions per second, and all that, it's extremely hard for any single party. Even Google cannot get more than about 4% or 5% of the total computing power. If somebody has 51% of total computing power, they can theoretically break Bitcoin. It addresses a double spending problem. If you spend it once, I can't give the same Bitcoin to somebody else. That would be just like copying my wallet and multiplying it. So that's all taken care of. All these are normal routine kind of things which have been already taken care of. The Bitcoin system maintains a decentralized tamper-proof community accounts. There's no central authority. So who will maintain accounts? That's a very serious question. So the solution that Bitcoin came out with is that the accounts will be distributed. Everybody can keep a copy of the accounts. So there are the blockchain, there are maybe at least about 10,000 copies or 7,000 to 10,000 copies. So first of all, there are multiple copies. Second, this is cryptographically protected through something called hashes. Now hashes are very interesting. I don't have time to get into that. It's a mathematical construct. But the hash thing is like this. You can take a big file or a small file and you hack in hash both. The length will be always the same. No matter what the size of the input is, the output is fixed size. And if you take an input, 1 GB file, and in that you change one bit, the hash changes completely. The full hash changes. So, and the third property is that given a hash, you cannot figure out where it came from. What is the original file? These are some of the properties of hashes which are used for these Bitcoins. So the problem is, who will maintain accounts if it is, if there's no central trusted authority? Normally, the bank maintains accounts for us, and we trust the bank. Some cases, the government maintains our accounts. For example, land records. In India, land records are maintained by government. We trust the government. But we see also that in Kerala, at least, the land records are falsified by the government staff sometimes. So can we trust the government? Is a problem. Can we put the data on the blockchain? If you put it on the blockchain, what happens is that becomes immutable. You can't change it. There's no way to change the blockchain. That is because Bitcoin history cannot be changed. So Bitcoin transaction history, which is on this blockchain, is immutable. It's a once write-only kind of a database. You cannot change it ever. So today we're talking about people, accountants talk about double entry book. you know what it is. But people are talking about triple entry bookkeeping. And the third entry going into the blockchain. Because that cannot be changed no matter what you do. Right. So this proof of work is a bit complicated. What it basically means that when in the earlier days of email, the spam issue came up. People want to send 50,000 copies of spam. How do you stop them? So one way to stop them was, and people like us want to send one or two per hour, they want to send 50,000 in 10 minutes. So how do you stop them? One of the ways to stop them was to make them solve, just take a captcha. You know what captcha is, right? When you go to some sites, it proves that you're not a robot. You tick something, you solve a small mathematical problem, what is 7 plus 5? Like that. So in the spam case, what happened is people said, we make them solve a small problem, which is not very trivial, but it takes some time. So people like us who had to send this one or two, it will take some time for us, but it's not a big deal. But somebody who has to send 50,000 mails, it's going to take a long time for them to solve those problems, for every mail. So that deters them. That's called proof of work. That's some work that you're making them do. In a very similar fashion, here, you're actually asking this community to solve a problem. So the effort is that there should be a commonly agreed upon record of transactions. And for that, there are many people who are trying to, in the community, who can make this record. Like many auditors sitting around in a place like the stock exchange, very noisy place, transactions are being announced by people who are transacting, and a group of people have to maintain accounts. So all of them can pick some 200 accounts and put it in a page and say, okay, this is another page to be added to the blockchain. But the problem is, everybody can, that work is actually very trivial, that you collect these transactions and put them in a page and add it to the blockchain. That is actually very trivial work. So anybody can do that. So how do you choose one and say, okay, this is the next blockchain? And why should you choose one? Because you get some money if you do that. If your blockchain is chosen, you get paid. Therefore, it's called mining. And the amounts are not trivial. You get, right now, 12.5 bitcoins. Each bitcoin is about $5,500. Talking about $60,000 every 10 minutes. $6,000 that are paid every 10 minutes. Okay, that's a lot of money that goes up. Now, how do you choose from all these competing people who are trying to make another page or another block in the chain by assembling these transactions? How do you choose one? Because there's no central authority. The central authority, you can check if this guy gets it next time. But you have to have a community consensus. And that is done by solving a hard mathematical problem. It is really hard. It's not like that email case. It is really, really hard. And it's a hashing, it's a reverse hashing, basically. The problem is, okay, generate a what is called as a nonce, N-O-N-C-E, this random number, which results in this hash. That's quite a difficult problem. There are no shortcuts. You have to just try random things and get that thing out. So all these people are trying that, because the database of transactions which are to be confirmed is public. You can assemble the next page, maybe with 200 transactions. But you have to solve this problem. If you get it right, you get paid $12.5, I mean, bitcoins. And that is your payment. So this way, block after block are created and added. Once every 10 minutes, typically, on an average. One of the problems in Bitcoin is that the transaction takes 10 minutes to confirm. It's not like credit card, Visa card, it gets confirmed in 5 seconds. It is actually a problem. So this proof of work is basically making these miners who are there on the public network solve a mathematical problem in order to consider their claim. Now, so this is also to dissuade dishonest miners, people who are trying to do double spending in the next transaction. So they will kind of try to do a little bit of fraud in that. But since they have to solve the problem, the chances are that, because you don't have so many malicious nodes, the chances are that the person who solved the problem is not malicious. But even if it's a malicious case, there are ways of working back. This is a real life system, this is real life money, and it's money, and people have been trying to hack Bitcoin for the last, from 2009 onwards. They have not succeeded so far. So all the normal tricks have been tried. It has not worked so far. So, well, then there is anonymity, pseudo-anonymity for parties. It is not real anonymity, but it is pseudo-anonymous. So people can be identified from their public keys. If you look at public keys, it's a long string. You cannot make out who it is. The transactions themselves are public. So many bitcoins have been transferred from this party to that party. Both parties cannot be identified. Not that they cannot be identified, but with difficulty. And who is this community who is deciding on this consensus and all that? It's open. Anybody can, you can buy a fast computer, put it on the internet, a fast internet, and you're part of the Bitcoin community. You can also start this mining process. But the chances are that you will not succeed because people have invested very large sums of money in very specialized hardware, which does this hashing. So there are things like hash pools and all that which I will not get into. What is innovative about Bitcoin? It's the first working example of a digital currency. People have been working on this for many years. It's not as if this has come out of the blue. There have been many intermediate steps earlier. But what is innovative? There's no central controller. Easy to transfer, to secure, to verify, to granulate. You can divide a Bitcoin into many, many small parts, around 10 to the power of minus 8. Predictable, limited in supply, not backed by gold, as most currencies are. So if you look at the Bitcoin value enhancement, it has gone up from a very small amount, less than one-tenth of a dollar, to this $5,000. So $5,000 is a lot of money, and this appreciation has happened in this whole period. Why did it happen? People keep on asking me, why does the price of Bitcoin rise? My usual answer is, just like the stock market, what drives up the stock, the price of the stock? It is the sentiment of the community concerned. There's no government there. It is actually a collective sentiment. So people have trust in Bitcoin. So tomorrow, if China bans Bitcoins, as they are about to do, there will be a problem. The Bitcoin price will be impacted. It won't crash, but it will kind of go down. So because that's also a factor, a national government banning. So the answer to that question as to what decides it is completely by the community. Freeze proof. There's no third party here, so nobody can freeze your account. Cheaper than fiat currency, cryptography. What can you do with Bitcoin? Suppose you had some Bitcoin in your wallet. Now, how do you do this? How do you buy Bitcoins? You will see there's something called a Bitcoin exchange. It's like a bank where you can go pay Indian rupees, your local currency, and buy Bitcoins. What do you mean buy Bitcoins? You have to provide an address, and the Bitcoin will be transferred to that. So you have to first create a wallet. It's all very simple now. You can either create a local wallet on your hard disk, on a laptop, but then you have to protect it. If the thing crashes, you lose all the money. You lose your private key, you lose everything. Or you can have a third-party website-based kind of a thing where people come and sit there. But tomorrow, that guy can shut shop and take all of the money with him. That has happened many times before. So it's your choice. The risk is still there. Remember, the intermediary was doing this for you earlier. The trusted intermediary was doing this for you. The bank was actually protecting your money and all that. Right now, with this, you have to protect your own money. Ultimately, you are responsible. You can receive Bitcoins, you can pay Bitcoins, you can create any number of addresses to receive Bitcoins. All of them will be yours. You can create a multi-party, multi-sig, you can create escrows. What does the network do? The Bitcoin network. The Bitcoin network is an open network. Anybody can join, anybody can exit anytime. But it's a community, and decisions are taken by consensus. The transactions are validated, and this process that we just discussed called mining. And the miner gets this amount right now. The amount is 12.5 BTC now, and even one BTC is $5,000. You can just multiply and find out. So that's a lot of money that they're going to get. Right. What is a Bitcoin exchange? A Bitcoin exchange is like a bank. There are now a few in India also, RBI approved. So what is the status of Bitcoin in India? Is it approved? Is it banned? Nobody knows. RBI is very, very fuzzy on this. RBI says, you use Bitcoin at your own risk. That doesn't mean anything. You know that we'll be using Bitcoin at our own risk. So anyway, right now the situation is gray. It is in the gray area. It's up to you to kind of use. I have still some Bitcoins left, but I mean, very little. No? I mean, very little money, but it's good to see that. Now, of course, we have moved on to Ethereum that you will see just now. So that's the status. Now, the Bitcoin exchanges also report to the law enforcement agencies. They do. Now, this whole thing about hawala, in India, there's something called hawala. Hawala is a transfer of funds from one country to India without or under the nose of the security agencies. it happens big time. Right now, the current government is trying to crack down on it. Now, hawala can happen through Bitcoin. You can transfer large amounts of money. So how does the government, why is the government not waking up to this fact? Actually, they have woken up to this fact much earlier. What they are saying is, we are bothered about this at two checkpoints. One is when you convert your rupees to Bitcoin, and the other is when you convert from Bitcoin back to rupees. At these two points, we will get information from these banks or exchanges. And we are only monitoring those two things now. You may do a lot of transactions, but nothing can happen till you convert that to rupees locally. At that point, the RBI is in the loop. So they are saying that's enough for the time being, which probably makes sense. Escrow transaction fees to support themselves. Well, how do you send it? It's actually now quite trivial. You can scan and you can just send, that's it. You need the other parties, either the long string that is the address or a QR code these days. So just scan it and send it, and till this point, your job is over here. All the rest of the loop happens between the community, all these machines. They're talking to each other, they're kind of clarifying it, etc. So in actual practice, it's quite simple. But the underlying technology that happens below is somewhat complex. So not controlled by any government. The wallet contains only private keys, not the money itself. If wallets are lost, you lose the access to the money. Transactions cannot be reversed once you make a payment, because there's no third party to kind of protect you. So it's between you and the other party. If you make a mistake in adding one more zero, finished. Your money is gone. And anybody with computing power more than 50% can potentially crack. Today, this is the price levels. $25 pizza was 10,000 BTC in 2010. And this month, Bitcoin has crossed 5,800. A total capitalization is about $95 billion. The basic protocol has not been hacked even once. But many people have lost money because many sites have run away with their money. People have lost the hard disks of the laptops and lost the keys, etc. The Bitcoin is forked twice, but I don't have time to explain what these forks are and why is it important. Is it a good investment? Depends on your level of risk-bearing ability, basically. If you can lose the money, you can afford to lose the money, you can go and invest. You may get double the money back in maybe 2 years. But if you like savings, don't risk it. Now, in summary, what did Bitcoin really do? The main point is this here, that the Bitcoin revolution is just trust. It's about trust. The third party that was required so far is now out of the picture. And that's what is, you know, the revolutionary aspect this case. But the other thing is that the blockchain, it turns out that the blockchain is actually even more important than Bitcoin itself. Okay, Bitcoin is a currency, but the blockchain has much more broader generic kind of uses than Bitcoin itself. So, okay, this is a blockchain in simple terms. There's a chain of blocks, each block containing many transactions. But most important thing is that there is a pointer here. This is a linked list for computer programmers. This is a singly linked list. This previous hash is a hash of the previous block, basically. So if you change even one bit in that block number 10, it won't tally. It will break the link. And this here is basically what is called as a Merkle tree. It's another data structure, which maintains as a tree structure a number of transactions, maybe some 200, 300 transactions in one block. So this is the basic structure of a blockchain. So a blockchain is called a blockchain because each is a block, and the entire thing forms a chain. And today, if you go to the internet and download a copy of the blockchain, you can get blockchains from the first block called the Genesis block. And the entire thing comes into your hard disk. It's about 20 GB now. So it's a very large download. And then you can operate your mining or whatever you want, transactions from your laptop itself without any other dependency. But what most people do is they get an account on a third-party website, and they kind of have a account there. So what is unique about the blockchain? The blockchain is immutable. That's very, very simple terms, that's what it means. Why is it immutable? Why cannot it be modified? For several reasons. One is that there are multiple identical copies. Another is that they're append only. You can't change it. It's cryptographically protected. If you change even one bit, the whole thing goes for a toss. You cannot try to change the historical blockchain for these reasons. And all this is done without any central authority. That's also very critical. What happened after the blockchain? Now, Lessig is a well-known figure in the... I have 5 minutes left, so... So Lawrence Lessig is a well-known lawyer. He's from Harvard Law School, and in the open source community, he's very respected. All the Creative Commons licenses and so on, he's actually created it. There are many alternate coins. So Bitcoin has some problems. One is that it takes 10 minutes. That's a huge delay. So there were several altcoins to kind of address some of these. But the other problem with Bitcoin is that it doesn't have a Turing-complete language. From a programmer perspective, Bitcoin's got a very... it's got a scripting language which is very deliberately very weak. Because Bitcoin people said, Satoshi said, we can't have a Turing-complete language because that might cause security problems. So make it a very rudimentary, minimal language. So from a programming perspective, it's not very programmable because it doesn't have a full language. So people said, we need a blockchain-based computing platform that can actually be have a full language, and that was Ethereum. And Ethereum is the most active space today in cryptocurrencies, and this is where a lot of things, much more than Bitcoin itself. So if you want to invest money, this is probably better than Bitcoin, maybe. Again, none of the advice that I give is valid advice, so don't take it. But in case you want to know for abstract reasons, okay. What is this Ethereum? Ethereum is like a one large computer consisting of many nodes. And you can give it code, like a smart contract. Suppose I want to transfer 100,000 rupees to my granddaughter who was born last December, when she's 18 years old. That's a smart contract. I can create a contract, put the money in, and I can die also, and give this to the Ethereum system. You have to pay a fee, because Ethereum requires the money to keep the system running. And that fee is consumed when you run this. But 18 years later, when the date comes, this is triggered, and it runs. And that's a simple example of the smart contract. So Ethereum, this is what happens. It's a platform. It's a full Turing-complete language that you can use. I will not get into details because there's no time. There's a particular currency also here, internal currency called Ether. There's something called gas, which is the utility fees that you have to pay for running these things. This is what is consumed. And you can convert, of course, between Ether and gas. Ethereum innovations, you can have any number. We can start a coin tomorrow. So you can start inSIG coin. So you can trade the coins. You can have some, it's like credits. This is a token. And the token can be, used for any purpose that you want to use. So it takes very little effort to kind of do this. And today there's also something called, just like IPO, there's something called ICO, initial coin offerings, in which people are making large amounts of money in a very senseless way. Even people with very little knowledge about Bitcoin, Ethereum, are making very large sums of money. And people are now alarmed about it, saying this cannot last, it's a bubble waiting to burst. Now, such is the amount of money that's being made today. Now, smart property, smart contracts, decentralized autonomous organizations. An organization is apparently a bunch of contracts. So if you can automate, you can make a smart contract, then you can create a whole organization using these smart contracts, only on code. So what Lawrence Lessig said, code is law. I don't have time to get into this, but one interesting use is, voting. Now in India, we use voting machines. Now voting machines, now in Kerala, for the first time, they tried what's called the VVPAT, that is voter verifiable audit trail, paper audit trail, VVPAT. So if you press a button earlier on, there's a beep and that's it. You don't know where it's gone, into which. Of course, you press whatever symbol, and it's supposed to go to that symbol, but you can't check. Okay, I think my time is up, so people are making faces at me, so I'll have to stop here. So this is some of the applications that you can use it for. Technical stuff, and I will stop here. I will not get into that even.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. There's a question. Maybe you take 2 minutes for some questions.
Yeah, we can take 2 minutes, but for the excellent coverage you gave into the two hot topics, blockchain and the darknet. So we will ask you to. Any questions?
How you got your money back?
How did I get my money back?
Yeah, after exchange.
Okay. Oh yeah, so there was an exchange here in India at that time. In December, by then, there was India-based exchanges where I could give the Bitcoin and get back Indian rupees. And then what happened was I had to report to my chartered accountant because it came into my account as I got so much of extra money. And there's a big problem because the chartered accountant does not know what is Bitcoin. So I had to tell, this is the Bitcoin, my office people had to kind of write letters. It took a long time, but I finally income tax people approved it and they didn't tax me. But today it may be different, they may tax.
So I'm curious to know escrow through multi-sig.
Escrow through multi-sig happens when there are, suppose I want to transfer the money to you, but I don't trust you fully. Suppose you give me money, you're supposed to give me something. But I'm not sure that you give me that something if I pass you the money. But if I pass the money, there's no way I can get it back. So how do I protect myself? I need a third party. So I do a multi-sig with three parties. Okay, and then I give the money. And if no problem is there, then the two parties is enough. Both of us will release the money. If there's a problem, then I can get the money back. The escrow, I have to pay a fee for that. But I can get the money back, there's a protection. So unless both of us release the money, it will not go to the third party.
So the third party is usually banks?
No. These are all independent people or entities. We don't know who they are. There's only an address. We don't know whether they're an institution or an individual or a group. No idea.
I think now we have to stop here. I think this has raised many questions and many I think observations people to make. I think your presentation made thinking more on these issues.